so, you know, I did CrossFit, yeah, for about 6 months or so, maybe a little more than that, starting after Nationals 2015. And that program, I was training a lot. And I don't know, yeah, I felt like I got better at stuff that I hadn't previously done before, which is kind of to be expected. But this is not related to that at all, to be honest. You know, if I was doing a CrossFit template, which I don't necessarily know if I feel qualified to do, you know, to come up with, then it would be quite different, mainly because you actually have metabolic conditioning workouts in there and probably more general conditioning. I mean, if it was for people who don't have a good strength base, then, you know, that's a different deal, but yeah, so not really. This is more inspired by what I've been doing since starting residency when I wasn't prepping for a meet. So train 3 times per week, hit the big movements, get a bunch of volume in that doesn't, you know, beat the crap out of you or take, you know, hours and hours to train. That's pretty much what inspired this. And then the AMRAP stuff tends to work pretty well for that, in my opinion. You did day 5 today. That's day 5. Your week starts on like what day is it? Today's Tuesday? Impressive. Oh, yeah. Okay. So hopefully the LP is going well there. We're getting some questions from Instagram, too, so I can answer to those. So how do I manage to train? Busy schedule, less sleep. Well, so I have a question on Instagram, like, how do I manage to train with less sleep? So if you're like me, you don't get a lot of sleep, and then you just train anyway. Yeah, it's just one of those things. You just get used to it. You know, 5 to 6 hours of sleep is pretty good for me on a given night, and I've been training like that for a few years. So you just kind of keep doing it, and you just make it happen. Because if you don't train, you feel worse. Last week, I actually didn't touch a barbell. It was 8 days from when I deadlifted 701 to when I actually trained again. And yeah, that was the longest I've ever gone without touching a barbell in probably 6 years. So, yeah. The other thing, you know, if some of you are busy, so the GPP template that we're talking about mainly is 3 days of actual, you know, strength training based stuff with 2 days of GPP. Theoretically, you could either condense or expand this. So what I mean by condensing, you could actually put the GPP days on the days you train with weights. So you would do your squat, your press, your, you know, dumbbell work on day 1, and then you could do the GPP session directly after. That would be fine. Or alternatively, if doing the first 2 big competition or, you know, priority lifts take up a lot of time, then you can defer the 3rd movement to a GPP day and then just, you know, kind of spread it out like that. So I like spreading sessions out for people who have busy work schedules that, you know, don't allow them to train very long each day. For people who do shift work, I actually prefer longer training sessions with everything kind of jammed in and then them not have to hurry after work or, you know, try to train after a 16-hour day. It's pretty tough for them to do. I've done it, but that's just kind of my preference. Yeah. And the other thing, you know, people will also ask, too, like, what do I do if I'm going out of town this weekend and I can't do, you know, like, I can't train Friday, Saturday, Sunday. Like, what do I do? I'm like, well, I would just jam all of your training Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday. It's better to get the training session in than to take the rest day but not train after the rest day. You know what I'm saying? So, or miss a training day. That'd be my preference. So I don't necessarily have a hard and fast rule about not training back-to-back days. I think that can work better for some folks, but I don't necessarily think it's absolutely necessary. Brian says, the type of person who goes all out always. So, yeah, I think, you know, if you have a problem with overshooting your RPE, I mean, every week you should be getting better at this. So the biggest question is, how do you get better at using RPE for your training? And the answer to that is to use it more. You just get better at it. And then I think, you know, big picture, understanding what we're doing here, which is doing a lot of volume, and therefore it has to be submaximal, then you should aim to make sure that your top set submaximal. The most important thing is getting the top set weight correct. And I think a couple things you can do. First, right after you rack the bar, you have your subjective interpretation. How hard is that set? You can video that at the same time and compare what it looks like on camera to what you thought it was. And basically, if you use those two things, you should be able to hone in on your weight. Another thing is once you do your first sort of warm-up set, like 6 reps at 7, usually upping the weight by about 5% and keeping the rep range the same makes the RPE go up 1. So for instance, if you did 300 for a set of 6 and you rated an RPE 7 and you wanted to know what your RPE 8 should be, if you add 5%, which is about 15 pounds, theoretically that should be about an RPE, 1 RPE more. Let's see. Yeah, so Vanessa asks, what's the total time? 30, yeah. It's 30 minutes. That was a typo. I'm not sure where that came from. Yeah, so every 30 seconds do a 30 minute. No, yeah, so just 30 minutes. Yeah, I messed that up. Also, just again, if you're, I think I got the mic. Just make sure your mic is muted. But yeah, I was a typo, and it pains me, so my OCD self is not okay with that. Just for the high intensity interval training stuff, so let's say you're in an area where it's cold outside and you you know, you don't have anything inside to do, you're kind of stuck in a way. I mean, it'd be nice if you had a bike or a rower or something like that to do your HIIT on, or you had access to a commercial gym, but if you're stuck, you got a home gym, don't have another place to go, what I would do is actually have somebody do like squats. You know, it depends how strong the person is, but if they could do bodyweight squats, if, you know, they're not squatting over 200 pounds, for instance, but if you're strong, then you can, or over two, you know, you can squat over 200 pounds, and you might think about doing about 20 to 30% of your 1RM for as many reps as you can and for the high intensity interval work part. So if there's 20 seconds on, minute 40 off, then in 20 seconds, doing as many reps as you can, about 20 to 30% of your 1RM. You could theoretically do that for your HIIT if you're kind of stuck. Leanne says, so if you wanted to jam this in Monday, Wednesday. So I think if you wanted to condense this particular program, which is 3 days of strength training, and then 2 days of GPP work, so what I would do is just do day one with the GPP tacked on the end of that. Take day two is off on Wednesday, just do day two as normal, and then take Thursday off, and then do Friday with your full session GPP after that. That's what I would do. I probably wouldn't train every day. You can, if that works better for you. But I do think maintaining at least, you know, a full day off in between sessions tends to work a little better. There's some evidence to support that as well. So what they did is they looked at, this was actually an endurance athletes, but people, they had them run the same amount of total volume. And, one group did twice a day, 2 day workouts and had full days off. And the other group did, trained every day, but did 2 days. And at the end of the, you know, the study, they basically tested them on, I believe it was a 5K, and they tried to see who did better. And the people who did the 2-a-day workouts and had preserved days off actually performed better. And which kind of makes sense. You know, having a full day off or a couple full days off between sessions tends to allow you to actually recover and subsequently perform a little bit better. But, you know, life happens, so. Yeah, it just depends. 80 miles, wow, that's tough. Yeah, so I think, you know, with your, Leanne, I think that's tough. You would, you know, figure out which option works best for you. But that's tough. Craig asks, day off of lifting, do HIIT and lifts have an impact on your day off? Yeah, absolutely. You know, so on the one hand, you could argue that it's an active recovery. There's some evidence to support that. And on the other hand, you could argue that having a full day off is likely more beneficial from a you know, fatigue dissipation standpoint. So fatigue is kind of this complex term that we use as a catch-all to talk about, you know, how basically stressed the individual is and how ready they are to train. So my take, and the current theory is that the brain integrates all of these variables, so like how much glycogen is in the muscles, how much lactate has been produced, how hydrated a person is, how warm it is outside, how, you know, what's the electrolyte status, all of these things, okay? The brain effectively takes into consideration all these different variables that we couldn't possibly enumerate here, okay? There's just too many. and then subsequently decides how well you can perform on a given day. Active recovery doesn't tend to improve all of those things to dissipate fatigue, whereas completely resting does tend to do that. So I think if you put a gun to my head and you said, Jordan, I want to perform better on each session, and then subsequently get more training stress or do better with the training, then you could make the argument that having the day off would be more appropriate in that regard. On the other hand, you could say that, well, if you training under a fatigued state ultimately produces even more fatigue, which as you recover from, you'll get better, and so maybe the outcome is about the same overall. But I don't necessarily agree with that, just based on my experience with others and myself. I do think that preserved day off tends to work better, not only between sessions, then also between the different weeks. So theoretically, you could take all of the workload and spread it out over 7 days. So your workouts would be much shorter. But I think you would do worse than concentrating the workouts into 3 or 5 sessions. The way I laid it out here was in 5 total sessions, because I think that works best for people's their sort of lifestyle. But if I had my druthers, it would be condensing everything into 3 or 4 workouts total. And they would just be longer. Does that kind of make sense? Fatigue is pretty complicated to discuss correctly, and I don't want to shortchange it and provide misinformation here. So if we have questions on fatigue, I'm happy to talk about it, but there's a lot of stuff that goes into that. One of the questions that I've been getting emailed to, and then I just got one on this on Instagram, is should nutrition be different between training and rest days? And the way I like to think about it, right off the cuff, the thought is, well, I'm not as active on rest days as I am on training days, so I should eat less on a rest day. But if you think about the recovery process and when that is going on for the most amount of time, it's going to be on your rest day, which takes up a lot of nutrients and requires a lot of fuel anyway. And your metabolism hasn't significantly changed from day to day either, so I think that nutrition should mostly be the same on training and recovery days, with the exception of a few different instances. If you're trying to lose weight and therefore you have to be in a calorically restricted state, you can make the argument that fueling training days so that your training stays productive would be useful. But for someone who's not really trying to lose weight, then I would say that nutrition should be the same across all days. Craig says, day off of lifting. Just curious because he got kicked out last Friday. Yeah, so, I mean, Craig, that's fine. It's better to have squatted than to just not. But, ultimately, I think condensing things and having preserved days off probably works a little better from a fatigue management standpoint. Mark asks, if you feel fatigued and a weight feels like an RP8, but on video it moves more like a 6 or 7, do you adjust the workout by actual performance versus how you feel? Are you at risk of accumulating even more fatigue if you go by performance if it feels like shit? So yeah, that's interesting. The purpose of using rate of perceived exertion is to use a subjective measure to kind of guide your workload, because ultimately how it feels to you tends to be a more accurate predictor of the stress it imposes on the body, because the stress from a workout is not just physical. There's an emotional component, and I'll give you two different scenarios. So scenario one, Mark goes into the gym, he does his workout listening to classical music, okay, no caffeine, there's, nobody in the gym, he just goes about his business, he's very zen, he may meditate between sets, okay, that's workout one. Workout two, if we split screen this, Mark goes into the gym. He's at a dusty old powerlifting gym filled with a bunch of people, listening to death metal, and somebody snorting either ammonia or maybe cocaine in the background. It's a very stressful environment. People are yelling at him, and this, that, and the other. And they do the same amount of reps, the same load, whatever. Well, which workout is more stressful? The one where he's expending more emotional energy to get up for the workout. You know, this is one of the reasons that when I work with you know, higher level athletes, I talk about regulating how much caffeine they're using pre-workout. If not every workout is do or die, you know, after you're kind of done with your novice progression. So I like regulating sources of additional stress when it comes to training. And so how that relates to Mark's question is, you know, if you're, how you feel is probably more tightly correlated with the stress that a workout has on your system than what it looks like on camera. I just use camera or even something like a tendo unit or open barbell, which measures the speed of the bar, as an additional information. Not, it shouldn't, one shouldn't supersede the other. You're just using all of this information together to make a good sort of judgment about what you should do for the day. Hopefully that makes sense. Somebody also asked me, I just got this question on Instagram. Someone asked me, is GoMad BS or not? And, you know, probably nobody in the GPP group is doing GoMad, just because, yeah, you've already gone through the novice progression. But people do ask a lot, like, is GoMad appropriate? And the thing is, for who? You know, if you're massively underweight and you're busy or whatever, I challenge you to find something that's more easily accessible, inexpensive, okay, and portable than a gallon of milk. That being said, you know, if you want to eat the same amount of food from other stuff, so your caloric intake is the same, that's fine too. It's just, milk is super easy. It's got a really good source of protein, really good source of carbohydrates, portable, cheap, all that other stuff. And so I don't know if you could say it's bullshit or not. That'd just be an incomplete answer. Yeah, so define massively underweight. It depends. If you're a strength sport athlete, then, you know, realistically, you need to look at how tall people are in your weight class. And if you're taller than them and you're in the same weight class, then you're massively underweight. If you're a novice, you know, it depends how tall you are and this, that, and the other. But that's a tough question to answer without context. Update on pre-workout. I actually emailed them today just to see what the deal was with shipping, because last time I heard that it was ready to go. So I'm trying to, I put all this money out there. I'd like to fulfill some orders. So as soon as I hear something, you'll hear something, and it'll be on the website, which has been updated. It's prettier now, I think. If you guys find bugs, let me know. I'm not a professional web developer, but I try. In case you were wondering about my attire, I am working nights now, which is, I think, a good thing to do after you think you either have the flu or atypical pneumonia. It's good, I think, to work nights. It's good for recovery. Training's been going really well. But yeah, so I actually have to go to work here in a little bit to work overnight tonight. Jonathan asks, what criteria do you use to know how much weight to add on your max lifts for the template on the following weeks? Yeah, so I wouldn't use how much volume you were able to do as the predictor for can you go up or not. More so, so here's the idea. So let's say you did 300 for six for your set at eight, and then you did all of your backups from there. The idea would be, well, you want to make your estimated 1RM go up week to week, or you want to add weight to the bar if the reps are staying the same and the intensity is staying the same. So, for instance, if you were doing 6 at 8 on the second week, you'd want to try to do 305. How you would know that you're doing 305, 305 was going to be approximately an 8 would be during your warm-ups, all right? So, you know, you're set at 6, you're set at 7 for your warm-ups would tell you, can you go up? But the idea is to go up every week. And you're gonna try until proven otherwise, and that you're gonna learn that in the warm-ups. And not every week's gonna be perfect. You know, you're gonna have some times where you overshoot or undershoot. But warm-ups tell you the story on that. If you're very poorly recovered, stress, sleep, loss of appetite, you feel like crap in the gym, do you reduce volume and intensity, or just go home and take another day off? So I don't think you should go home and take a day off. Because I think if you're getting, you know, depending on where you're at in your training, if you're right for a meet, you know, things become a little tenuous. You know, what should you do to optimize performance on meet day? But if you're in a developmental sort of stage, which everybody's following the GPP template is right now, my recommendation would be to just take some weight off the bar and go by, you know, the RPE is going to feel what it's going to feel like at, you know, at whatever the weight is. So if you're feeling run down, the weight's just going to be lighter, and just do the work. I would do the volume for sure. And the absolute intensity is going to be a little lower. My recommendation would be to continue on. But in that instance, I wouldn't use caffeine to get up for the workout, because the workout's already stressful because you're a little sick, you know, or you feel like crap already. You don't need to add, you know, insult to injury and, you know, make the workout more stressful, you know, by adding caffeine. And the idea is that caffeine is just a, you know, central nervous system sort of stimulant, you know. It's on the spectrum. So the spectrum is like cocaine and amphetamines over here, and caffeine's here, and then, you know, things that are depressants like alcohol or whatever are on the other side. And so it's just that the stimulant, the stronger the stimulant and the higher the dose of the stimulant, the more central nervous system sort of energy, which is a nebulous term, I grant you that, that you're expending on it for a given workout. Yeah, Craig, exactly. It would just be already by the RPE. Mm-hmm. So another question would be, I have gotten some people on the template are asking, when do they know if they're at the end of their novice progression? And, which is actually a pretty easy answer, you know, in absolute terms. You know that you're at the end of the novice progression when you can no longer add weight to the bar from session to session. You know, the harder question is that time to reset or time to move on? And, I don't have any absolute recommendations on that, but the real, the sort of, there's two pathways you can go. So pathway one is for what I call the former athlete, and pathway two is what I call the former couch potato. All right. So if you're a former athlete, you've been very active so far, your general base of conditioning, of training, of exercise is, you know, relatively high. So, you know, this is the person who played sports in college and high school but had never really formally trained. So they have a pretty good work capacity already, in that their recovery is pretty good. They just are now deciding to train with barbells. For them, I would only make them reset once or twice, tops, you know, providing they didn't go on vacation or get injured or something like that. The former couch potato has no base of conditioning and of training, and so effectively them trying to recover from anything is a much greater task. That will improve with training, and so what I effectively do is make them reset more times than I would the former athlete, because effectively we're just building their work capacity. So the former couch potato, I might reset four or five different times before having them move on. In any case, I can universally say that nobody, and I repeat, nobody should be running the novice progression for a year. Okay, if you have, then you got hurt, you took a break, you went on vacation, or you did something else, like in that time. But if you think about it, how much would your squat be at the end of the year if you started the empty bar and you added 5 pounds per workout 3 times a week? You know what I'm saying? I mean, that's 15 times 52. Your squat is very heavy at the end of the year. And so for most people, the novice progression proper, without any sort of modification, should last 3 months, 4 months, maybe a little longer, with a couple resets in there. Yeah, so I got a question on Instagram that when will I do my next podcast with Brent McKay. He actually just sent me an email to my other account today, so maybe soon. Maybe soon. I don't know why he wants me back on here, but I appreciate you guys asking. Somebody asked on Instagram about chin-ups developing biceps and if I thought that curls were more useful. And so in the GPP program, you guys saw that I program some upper back work, just an AMRAP, and then also some optional arm work. The deal with arms is that it's volume responsive. And in that same argument that, you know, more volume makes the things grow, more makes the arms grow, is frequency. So consider this. Let's say you were a bro, a bodybuilding bro, and you worked out, you did your arms one day a week. You just smoked them. So much so that you couldn't even move them the next day. You have a sweet pump, all this other stuff. The problem with that is you've concentrated all this volume in one workout, And once you reach this threshold where you've done enough to stimulate the muscles to grow, you don't get any more growth by doing more work. So anything past that, from a training volume and fatigue standpoint, is a waste when it comes to building muscle. Not necessarily building strength overall, but just building the muscle. And so you would make the argument that instead of training, focusing all of your training in one day, you should do arms multiple times per week. Okay, that generally increases as your training career goes further. So you would get more total growth. Theoretically. So does chin-ups hit the biceps significantly enough to make them grow? Absolutely. The issue is doing enough volume and frequency on chin-ups for a more advanced lifter may actually produce too much fatigue overall, whereas something like a bicep curl would produce less fatigue because the weight's less, the range of motion's less, the amount of muscle mass being used is less overall. So, you know, you just have to weigh your options depending on your programming. But for us, we just do, we're kind of increasing the volume and exposure to those sort of things over time. But you notice that the time does increase, and that's, you know, one of the things people go, oh, I wish I had bigger arms. It's like, okay, well, what have you been doing for them? And it's usually something a little haphazard versus programming intelligently. Make sure if you just joined in that your mic is on silent. I got you. Also apologize for sounding so congested. I don't normally sound this annoying. Or maybe I do, depending on who you ask. Let's see. What is a reset? So if you're doing, whose mic is that? If you're doing start, I'm muted? Am I unmuted now? All right, cool. So, if you're doing the novice progression, what is a reset? It's basically, let's say you work up to 200 for three sets of five, and then you go to 5 pounds next time for 205 for three sets of five, but you don't quite make it. So a reset would be taking about 10% off the bar, you drop 20 pounds off there, back to 180, do three sets of five, and then work back up from there. So you just reset it. Somebody asked if LP, linear progressions, this is more novice stuff, so if you're currently running that, it's maybe useful to you. Is there any difference between a male and female LP? And yes, in general, females can do a higher percentage of their one rep max or reps, meaning that a heavy set of five is a different experience for them from a training adaptation standpoint. For instance, a heavy set of five for a guy is significantly intense, such that three sets of five likely produces the amount of fatigue that's needed to drive adaptation for the next week. Whereas a female, that may not happen after the first few weeks. They may need something a little more intense. So what a lot of us have just kind of come up with, by us I'm referring to starting strength coaches, instead of females doing three sets of five ad nauseum, they do five sets of three. Because a heavy set of three for a female is closer to a heavy set of five is for a guy as far as training adaptation and stimulus. Just something we found through experience. So I don't have any studies or meta-analyses I can link you to on that. That's just been my experience. Let's see. Mark asks, what are some signs of failing sets reps from fatigue versus not enough volume? Yeah, so that's the question. So if you fail a set, you have to figure out, was it not enough stress previously to drive the adaptation, or was it not enough recovery from the previous accumulated stress, so you didn't actually recover to supercompensate? And that's the million-dollar question. It's pretty complicated, but my gestalt or my general feeling about this is, most of the time, it's not enough stress when coming from the novice progression. Just in general, people are used to that. I do all my stress on one day, I recover in a certain period of time, and then I can be better next time. But that's not really what happens once you move past that. You need more stress accumulated over a series of workouts. You know, and then as you get further and further along in your development, you need more and more stress to be developed over a series of weeks of workouts. And then usually you can realize the improvements from that accumulated stress in a pretty short period of time. You know, for some it's going to be a little shorter than others, but we're talking a week, 2 weeks tops until you get really far advanced. So I find that as long as there's not something that happened the day of or the night before this sort of the training event, you know, a girlfriend broke up with you, or you end up working a 16-hour shift when you're only supposed to work 8 hours, then in general, not enough stress was applied previously. And that's kind of the experience that I've had with people doing the novice progression, is that they'll fail a set, all right, and then they'll just move on to the next lift. And then when they come back the next time, they're just going to try to repeat the workout. But they didn't have enough stress that previous workout to make them any better than they were. Does that make sense? In fact, their volume went down. So my recommendation is if you fail a set, the idea is take weight off the bar, do the volume that you were supposed to do that day, and then you can try to repeat the workout the next time, unless you have an identifiable source for the failure. Sam wants to know, filling out the log sections necessary? No, it's not. It's your world. what I'm going to do afterwards is send out a questionnaire just looking at how people did, collect some data. So it might be easier for that, but you don't have to respond. I won't force you to. Somebody asked, when you switch, if you're female, do an LP from 3 sets of 5 to 5 sets of 3? It's kind of a judgment call. Usually I just let it happen organically so that, you know, they failed a set of 5 but got 3 reps, then I just start from there. Let's see. Andy asks, there's no deload week in the program. The first week's a pretty low stress week, so that's kind of the intro deload, but I wouldn't, you know, routinely program a deload for a GPP program like this. After the 6th week, I would do one for sure. Because you see the intensity ramps up the last 3 weeks. So it was intentional to do that. Somebody asks, how to prevent overarching of the low back with the overhead press? So we do arm pressing overhead quite a bit in the program. Easiest way to prevent overextending the low back is going to be to brace your abs prior to initiating the press. By bracing abs, what I mean is you're literally trying to pull down from the base of your sternum, your xiphoid process, down to the pubic symphysis. So basically you're contracting your abs down. It's kind of like the hollow position. But if you can actively contract those before you press, it'll prevent you from overextending. Belt can help too. I've also seen people who just start an overextension in the belt, and the belt just prevents them from getting hurt from doing it. Which, you know, is useful too, not getting hurt. So someone on Instagram asks, what are my thoughts about using body weight movements only for upper body development? And as you guys see in the program, I think that that is a suboptimal choice for developing strength, size, and any physical characteristic that you want to consider. So you're just leaving gains with 3 Zs on the table. It's, you know, no matter how, you know, much the leverage changes, you just can't load it as heavy for the amount of volume. And it's just, at some point, you're doing more gymnastics, which does require you to be strong, but is, you know, overall compromising the development of the muscle. Maybe a question that you guys have is when to start using the belt. I don't have any real hard and fast recommendation or absolute recommendations. The deal is this: if you have a back injury, you should be using a belt on all of your lifts. And the idea is that it's not a crutch. Okay? In fact, you can make the argument that the abdominal musculature is actually has a higher activity at a given weight using the belt. The idea is that it helps you train more productively for a longer period of time without getting hurt. which is useful, right? If you're not, if you don't have a history of a back injury, in general, when guys get into the mid to upper 200s, I have them start using a belt. They should have ordered the belt probably when they started training, because it'll come in a series of weeks, and they're going to need it then. Women, and they're squatting in the, you know, mid to upper 100s, it's probably a good time to start using the belt. Yeah, if you have a back injury, I would use it, or history of back injury, I would use the belt on your resistance list too, for sure. How to pick a belt, if, again, hard and fast rule, if you're a big, strong guy, you know, over 200 pounds, over 5'8" or 5'9", and you, you know, have been lifting for a while and moving some pretty good weight, I would pick a 4-inch wide, 13 millimeter thick belt, single prong. If you are smaller than that, or a female, I would pick a 10 millimeter belt that's 3 inches wide. If you are a competitive powerlifter and a female, you may want to try a 4-inch belt just to see how you do. But if you're not a competitive powerlifter, probably wouldn't routinely recommend a 4-inch belt for a female unless they're very tall. Yeah, if you have a, quote, tricky back, I'm not necessarily sure what that means other than it hurts probably off and on, which kind of tells me you have a history of a back tweak or injury, which case the belt recommendations apply there. What else? Somebody on Instagram said that they herniated C6, C7, C7 to T1, infusion L5, S1. Should you do squats, deadlift, and press? Yes, you should. And you should see a starting strength coach to make sure you're doing it correctly, and then go from there. Because the deal is, you need to be strong too. You can't just get deconditioned. That'll make everything worse. This is the last question I'll probably take from Instagram, and then I'll answer Brian's question, and then we'll go. And then this is being recorded, and if my YouTube thing's approved, I'll post it on YouTube. If you want to avoid quads growing too much, should you just stay at 225 for 5 reps by 5 sets? No. If you're not gaining weight, you're not growing muscle. So if you don't want your quads to grow, don't gain any weight. Brian asks, for the hip sled work, better to push lighter weight further or heavier weight not as far? Heavier weight not as far in general. You shouldn't be able to do an all-out sprint on the thing, but it shouldn't be a walk either. And your legs should be pretty pumped up by the end of the deal, so moderately heavy weight for sure. Leanne asks, you notice the squat and bench that your time on progressing 5 lasts a bit more than twice as long as your progression on 3s, 2s, and 1s. And you combine, and you notice that your deadlifts can't continue to 5s much longer. I don't think there are any implications on that. I think that in general, the further, like 5s are a decent compromise on strength, hypertrophy and all that other stuff, and it's not terribly similar to a 1RM, so it's more about building strength versus testing strength. But as you get closer to 3s, 2s, and certainly 1s, you're just closer to your 1RM, especially being a female. So, yeah, I would expect 5s to last longer from progression-wise, because I think that's more about building strength than 3s, 2s, or 1s.